All right, I'd like to encourage everybody to make their way to a seat. As you see, we are still trying to socially distance. We are trying to be as good as we can be, given the situation. We are glad to have you here. I'm glad to be able to hold church. I'm glad to be able to preach. And so I'm going to share a couple of announcements, and then the praise team is all ready to go. Cheryl and Dennis have been on vacation. They still are. And so, Becky, are you here, Becky? Yay! It's so good to have Becky on, Becky Brooks on the piano. And so, all right, back to where I'm supposed to be. All right, let me go through the announcements now, and then we'll get started. Remember, we're doing a character checklist. As we go through chapters 4 and 5 of Ephesians, it is so very practical. It deals with things that we need to deal with, like how we talk, whether we can get angry. And today, this is a tough one. Forgiving like Jesus forgave. Are you forgiving like Jesus forgave? And so we're going to see that from chapter 4 in just a couple of minutes. And by the way, next week I think it's on shining like Jesus shone. And so it'll be a very uplifting one. We encourage everybody to be here. Operation Christmas Child. According to my notes, those boxes are due November 15th, right? And if you still would like a box, these go to kids through Franklin Graham's organization. And just see, Sherry, she can probably, do you have any more boxes left? She has more boxes, and it's just a great way for us to be involved. And we are just really enjoying our involvement with the children in Awana. This is providing something for the kids where it's FaceTime with other people. We do try to socially distance. We're trying to be good sports about that. But the kids are really hungry for this, and I appreciate all the leaders that are involved. Now, having said that, Thanksgiving is coming. And good news for Brad Nichols. You don't have to cook, do you? No, he's back there giving me the thumbs up. Nor do I have to get up here and plead for frozen turkeys, which for 7 years I've had to plead. Brad would always say, we don't have enough turkeys yet. And then we ended up probably usually with more turkeys than we knew what to do with. But we always got the turkeys, didn't we, Brad? And it was a great feast. Here's how we're going to alter that. We've talked to Smoke and Bird, and we said, I'll bet you guys are good at turkeys and mashed potatoes and all of those things. Oh, yeah, that's right down their alley. They're going to cater it for us, but we're going to hold it in our fellowship hall. We're going to properly distance the tables, and we're going to have a feast, a Thanksgiving feast. Invite your family and friends. We have always had enough room to handle everybody. What will happen is, starting in a couple of weeks, we're going to start taking reservations. Because we're going to have to let them know in advance how many people are going to be there. But we'll tell you more, okay? November 22, that's usually the Sunday before Thanksgiving. So just jot that down. And then just pray. Let's have a word of prayer. And we need to continue to pray for our nation. Things are really unusual. And we need to pray that the will of God gets done in this country during the election, during the nomination of another Supreme Court justice, for the churches, so many of which, I think just about every church is still struggling. They don't know what to do, how to do it. And for the business people in San Diego County, they were closed, now they're open, now they're saying they may be closed again. And I talked with some of these people. They said they don't even want to order food because they have no idea what's going to happen from 1 week to another. So a lot of small businesses really struggling. That means people are struggling. And so we just ask that you continue to remember them. Let's have a word for it. Father, we do lift up our nation to you. We pray, Father, that your will be done. And Father, it's our prayer that righteousness will fall on this nation, that people will repent of the sins. There are many sins in this nation. And Father, we specifically talk about abortion. We think that is the national holocaust that's going on. And we know what you think of that. And we fear for the consequences. But have us put our trust in you, Lord. Help us to remember that you're in charge. We do pray for our leaders. I pray that they would be sensitive and listening to your will in their lives and in their judgments. Pray for our Supreme Court Justice nominee. Thank you for her professional courage she has displayed. Help her as she goes through this process. Now, help us to switch gears, put all of the troubles of our nation behind us, and look at what you want us to do as far as forgiving, like your son Jesus Christ forgave. Help us in our songs to raise up praises to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Good morning. It's great to be here. I'd like to invite you all to stand, and we'll go ahead and start our worship.
All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself.
may be seated.
I so appreciate the praise team. I so appreciate the praise team and all of the work that they put in. And sometimes they have more than other weeks. And last week we had a stage full of people. And this time a couple of them are gone. And we just appreciate the faithfulness of those that are here, those that continue to work. And I appreciate you listening to me as I preach the Word of God. And that's what I'm about to do today. But we're going to talk about something that may be a little difficult for some of you to deal with. And it's on forgiveness. Now, as many of you know, I have been working on a book. I've got several of them out, and I'm ordering some more of the ones that are already gone back there, and we make those available to the people of church. But I have been working on a major, major study. It's called Cracking the Mysteries, and it deals with UFOs, contacting the dead, out-of-body experiences, the reality of hell. Are there degrees of punishment in hell? What happens to you the moment of death? What is heaven like? What is your heavenly body going to be like? And we take it all from a biblical perspective and the role of demons. And so this has been a difficult time because whenever you attack the kingdom of Satan, the demons, you pay a price for that. The good news is I'm all done with writing 15 chapters, and the editor's got it, and the research assistant is doing all the fact-checking, and so my hands are clean of it for a while, so I feel good about that. But as I did it, I read a lot of stuff by atheists, and I read about debates that individuals had with atheists, Dinesh D'Souza being one of those. And he talks about how they think and how they respond. And one of the comments that one of the authors made was, they debated an atheist who did not believe there was a God, nor could God tell us everything to do. However, in life, he showed genuine Christian love. He looked like, and he by belief he was an atheist, and by practice, he looked close to what the model of Christian ought to be, especially when it came to forgiveness. And then the author went on to say, unfortunately, there are many Christians who have the doctrine of Christianity, but the practice of atheism. What do we mean by that? They believe like Christians, but they behave like there is no God and there is no expectation from God. When it comes to forgiving, they say they believe in God, a God whose son said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, but they failed to forgive like Christ. So today, we're going to look at the passage where it says we need to not only forgive, but we need to forgive like Jesus Christ, the Son of God, forgave. Now, let me tell you something. That really raises the standard. And so we'll look at that. Now, I'd like to set the stage with an example of what happened to a missionary of the Methodist Church in the early days when the Methodist Church was expanding through the North American continent. The missionaries were going out and speaking to the tribes, the Indian tribes, the Native American tribes, about Christ. And one missionary reported a powerful, powerful chief. His name was Maskapitun. Maskapitun. I'll call him the chief. And so the chief would listen to this missionary through a translator, and he came to know Christ as his Savior. And it reports that one evening he was listening to the missionary, and the missionary spoke on Jesus on the cross, his dying prayer, Father, forgive them. And he was overwhelmed with his need to be forgiven. But the next day, a band of the tribal Indians started to approach. And immediately, the chief saw someone in that band. You see, what had happened is that band had taken off earlier, and his son, his only son, was part of that band. And he pulled, the chief pulled his son's best friend aside and said, your job is to protect this friend of yours, your best friend, my only son. And what happened is while they were out, the report came back that the chief's son had slipped and fallen off a cliff and was killed. Well, that's not the end of the story, because some of the other braves saw what really happened and reported it to the chief. That best friend, who was supposed to protect him, pushed him off the cliff, his only son. And as the chief is standing there into the village, he sees this band coming, and he grabs his tomahawk. He gets on his horse, he rides out to meet them. They're face to face with the chief clutching the tomahawk in their hands. When they got together, he said this to the man, you deserve to die. I sent you, his trusted companion and friend, with my son, my only begotten son. And you broke the trust and you killed him. You have done me and the tribe the greatest injury that is possible. You deserve to die, but for what I heard from the missionary at the campfire last night, I would have already buried this hatchet, this tomahawk in your head. The missionary told us that if we expect the Great Spirit to forgive us, we must forgive the greatest wrong. And he said, you have become my worst enemy, and you deserve to die. As I hope this Great Spirit will forgive me, I forgive you. Chief turned, wept, and walked away. How are you doing with forgiving? Are you able to forgive those, not just that are friends of yours that slipped up, but those that you would consider your greatest enemy? Here's what the Bible says. We're going through Ephesians chapter 4, and on verse 32, it says we are to imitate God's kindness. Kindness. It's not talked about much, but it is so important in life. It says this, be kind and compassionate to one another. Okay, so if you get nothing else out of this sermon, I want you to remember you are to be kind and compassionate to one another. And then it says, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. Now, when we look at the miracles of Jesus Christ, I am overwhelmed with the fact that he could have done anything to impress people. He could have made mountains fall. He could have taken stars and circled them around the sky. He could have frozen the sun in place. He could have done anything. But when you look at the miracles of Jesus Christ, they were acts of kindness and compassion. He expressed the love of God through the kindness that he showed. Are you doing random acts of kindness? Now, maybe this is something you go through today and say, have I done anything kind recently? For my spouse, have I, without being asked, done the dishes? Have I sent a card of compliment to somebody? Have I done a small gift? Size of gift, doesn't matter. Have you called people you haven't talked to for a while to encourage them? Maybe you need to talk to your parents or your children. It's hard to go visit anybody in a hospital now or in an extended care area because of the COVID, but what can you do to get through to them by sending a card? Can you encourage a child? One of the greatest things we can do is acts of kindness to encourage children. The old preacher, the great preacher, Gypsy Smith. Now, what a name. If I had that name, Gypsy Cool, I think that would just be phenomenal. Gypsy Smith. People ask him how he felt compelled to be a preacher of the gospel. And he said, when I was a boy, I went to hear Dwight L. Moody preach. And he was a great preacher, but I was impressed by the song leader, Ira Sankey. And he said, after the service, for some reason, Ira Sankey came up to me, just a kid in the audience. He put his loving hand on me and he said, boy, someday God will make you a great preacher. And he said, those words were never forgotten by me, nor that encouragement, nor that kindness. And in fact, he became a great preacher. We are to imitate God's kindness. We're also to imitate God's compassion. I've already spoken about that. How there are verses in the Bible that when you look at them, it says Jesus was moved with compassion. As Jesus is looking over Jerusalem and he knows what's going to happen, and with tears in his eyes, you can hear this statement. He was moved with compassion. And we hear that, we don't think of much. But when we know that those words mean more in the Greek, it means they were physically in agony because of their compassion. He saw the people that were going to be sentenced to death, to hell. They were going to reject him, and he knew what lay ahead for them, and he was physically moved with compassion. We are to show the kindness and compassion of God. But now let me get to the third one. We are to imitate God's forgiveness. And this is where we're going to park for a while. This is the main thrust of this sermon. We are to imitate the forgiveness of God. One another, for teacher, just as in Christ, God forgave you. So, one another, for teacher, just as in Christ, God forgave you. So, here are some bullet points on this. If you want to remember forgiveness, remember these things. Number one, forgive measure a person's love for God and others is by how well they are at forgiving. Or do they hold a bitterness? And if they do, you have to say, you know what? Maybe their love isn't as great as I thought it was. The second thing, we are to forgive others just like God forgave you. And how did God forgive me? Okay, just think about how God forgave you. He didn't forgive you because you deserved it. He didn't forgive you because you were pleading with him. And he didn't forgive you with conditions. He forgave you without being deserved, without being requested, and without conditions. That's the love of God. He said on the cross, Father, forgive these people, for they know not what they do. And they were crucified. Now, when it applies to salvation, talk about salvation. We must first realize we're sinners. One of the greatest tasks that we need to get people saved is to get them lost. Sometimes people try to get saved without getting lost. In other words, they don't realize they are sinners. They just pick up all of the attributes and all of the activities of a church, but they have never reached the point where they have realized that they are sinners standing in the need of forgiveness. So, as one old friend of mine said, the biggest problem we have with reaching Hindus is not getting them saved, but getting them lost. They all want to be saved, but they don't want to come to grips with the fact that they need to be saved because they are lost in the sight of God. The third thing I would say is the greater the debt, the greater the forgiveness. Now, as I prepared this, I got hooked up on chapter 7 of Luke. And there's the story of a woman there, and you may remember the story. I won't read the whole story. But in the 7th chapter, starting with verse 36, Jesus is having dinner with some Pharisees. And they are the religious leaders. We just throw that term out, Pharisees. And every time you hear it, you know I'm going to talk about the bad guys. Well, they were the religious leaders. And they were the ones that set the standards as far as their expectations for people. And Jesus was there, and into that dinner came a woman. We know her as the woman with the alabaster jar. Now, what does that mean? Well, first of all, she was a prostitute. It's clear. That's made clear. And the alabaster jar contained very expensive perfume. Now, you say, where did she get the money for that? By being a prostitute. They all knew, the Pharisees knew she was a prostitute, and what in the world is she doing at our dinner? And she walked in. And what did she proceed to do? You know the story. She started, her tears were flowing so much that she began to wash his feet with her tears. Now, the Pharisees had neglected to wash his feet as a common courtesy when he came in. You always did that, but they didn't. And here's this woman comes in, and with the tears flowing, she's washing her feet with her hair. And then she breaks open the alabaster jar of expensive perfume and anoints his feet and washes it. And they're all over this. You know, how can you let this woman do it? And Jesus started into them with a story. It concludes in verse 47 where it says, therefore, after he tells the story, which I'll tell you in a minute, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little. And he's saying that it's those people that are forgiven from the more serious sins that tend to have the greatest love. They're the ones that grow in that love. And then he told the story just before that of two debtors and how one was forgiven who owed a lot, then went out and started beating down people that owed him money. You know the story. And Jesus said, look, you need to forgive as you were forgiven. Robert Falconer was teaching a group of people on the street. And he had a street ministry. And he had told this story. And the people were there, the poor, the destitute, street people, drug addicts, alcoholics, homeless, prostitutes. And after he spoke about that, one of the women who was a prostitute and showed all of the wear and tear of living on the street came and asked him a question. He said, is Jesus coming again? She said, I have heard about this Jesus and I want to trust in this Jesus, but is he coming again? And so Falconer, the preacher, said, yes, he is. Why do you ask? And so she said, with a burst of tears in her eyes, he said, she put her bony hands up to her thin, colorless hair and said, sir, can't he wait a little bit longer? My hair isn't long enough yet to wipe his feet with tears. And so you look at that and you realize Christ loves to forgive those that other people have given up on. Number four, forgiveness is neither an option nor a suggestion. And when it says forgive like Jesus forgave, well, let me just go to the Lord's Prayer. I would guess just about everybody here has recited the Lord's Prayer probably many, many times. And here's what it says about forgiveness. It goes through a bunch of stuff, but what does it focus on? The closing statement is the focus. It says we should pray, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. You say, whoa, wait a minute, but I'm a Christian. Well, then you ought to be forgiven. But I think what it is saying is that if your life is characterized with a lack of forgiveness, it is not evidence that you truly are a believer. And if you expect to live like that, someday you may face God, and he said, sorry, I never knew you. Forgiveness is an essential characteristic of the Christian life. And when it is missing, if it's missing in your life, beware. There is something seriously wrong. Number five, there is no point where forgiveness is exhausted. We are required to forgive regardless of the number and magnitude of offenses by an offender. Now, Peter went to Jesus and he heard Jesus talk about forgiveness. And he came to Jesus in Matthew 18:21 and said, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times? Now, you need to know something. The Pharisees, they came up with all kinds of rules about everything. And they had rules about how many times you had to put up with something and still forgive a person. And I don't remember what it was, whether it was three or four or five. Here's what I do know. Peter was somewhat boasting. In other words, I will forgive up to seven times. Lord, how many times do I have to forgive? I'm willing to go seven. And he probably expected Jesus to say, hey, good man. You know, because the Pharisees only require four or five, whatever it was. But then Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, Peter, but 70 times seven. And that's a number indicating unlimited. There is no limit to the number of times you have to forgive. You just have to keep forgiving. Now, in Matthew 18, it talks a little bit about this, and it gives a story. And so I'm going to tell you a story. Just relax. Let me read the story from Matthew 18. And it's all about forgiveness. It says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. But the servant fell on his knees before him and said, be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back. Everyone's master took pity on him and canceled the debt and let him go. But when that servant went out, one of his fellow servants who owed him only 100 denarii, I mean, chump change compared to the 10,000, he grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. And his fellow servant fell on his knees and begged him, be patient with me, I will pay you back. Same words he had used. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. And when the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and sent and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? And in anger, the master turned him over to the jailers until he could pay back all he owed. And Jesus concludes by saying, this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. Now, are you getting the picture? God doesn't like it when we don't forgive. The picture there is Jesus took us and forgave a debt we could not pay. And we had no resource to repay that debt. And he's saying, can't you at least forgive somebody that owes you something in a temporal way? Number six, we are required to forgive even the worst of our enemies. Years ago, I heard a story about a pastor by the name of Tom loved him. He was just a lovable guy. And everybody loved Pastor Miller, except for one guy. Now, I still have one guy that keeps slicing my tires. So there's a guy like this somewhere in this community. But there was one guy in their community that was probably even more belligerent, Pastor. And nobody in town liked him. As a matter of fact, later they discovered, this was during the Revolutionary War, that this guy had committed treason. He was a traitor to the country. And so now he had George Washington on his tail. And George Washington got him. And George Washington sentenced him to hang by his neck until death. Well, when Pastor Miller heard about this, he was about 60 miles away from this whole scene. And he immediately went to General Washington and started pleading that this man might be forgiven. And Pastor Miller said, my friend, this is my worst enemy in the world, but I'm still pleading for his life. There's something I need to do. And he issued a written pardon. And so Miller immediately took it to the place of execution. And there was Esau coming with 400 armed men. So Jacob divided up the children amongst Leah, Rachel, and his two maidservants. And he put the maidservants and their children in front, Leah and her children next, and Rachel and Joseph in the rear. Now, you can tell who his favorite was. The first ones were cannon fodder. If they got shot, it happens. But he wanted to protect his favorite wife and Joseph. And I hope Joseph remembered this, because Joseph is going to have to do some forgiving someday. And it says, Jacob himself went on ahead, bowed down to the ground, seven times as he approached his brother. This is tough, man. I defrauded my brother. But Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him, threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept. And then Esau looked up and saw the women and children. Who are these with you? He asked, and Jacob answered, they are the children God has graciously given your servant. Esau forgave. And then Joseph, he was in the back with the favorite wife, if you would. And when he had a chance, after he had been sold into slavery by his brothers. You remember the story in Genesis? How when they met, they were petrified once they learned who he was, but he forgave them. We hear the story of David being pursued by Saul, and David having that opportunity to take the life of Saul, but his comment, I will not lay my hands on God's anointed. It wasn't time. Let God take care of that. He forgave Saul. And then there was Stephen, the first one to die in the day of the church, the first martyr. And you know the story and how he was nearing death, it says he looked up to heaven and he saw the glory of God. You know, and I'm dealing with these near-death experiences in this book, and this is a biblical account of one. And he said, I looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. In other words, standing to greet him. Look, Stephen said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. This incensed the crowds. At this, they covered their ears and yelling at the top of their voices. They all rushed Stephen, dragging him out of the city and began to stone him. And meanwhile, there was a witness where they laid their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul, later be known as the great apostle Paul. He'll never forget what Stephen said next. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and he cried, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. That's tough when people are stoning you to death. And with that said, he fell asleep. And then there's a case of Jesus. You talk about forgiving those that hate you, those that crucified you, the case of Jesus. He said, Father, forgive them. Here's a seventh point. A refusal to forgive will poison your life. If you don't forgive, my friend, you will have bitterness, a seed of bitterness growing in you. Corrie Ten Boom. I've read so many quotes by Corrie Ten Boom recently on forgiveness. I mean, she was the one that suffered greatly at the hands of the Nazis, and yet she almost epitomizes a person that's got a heart of forgiveness. Here's a couple of things she said. She said, forgiveness is the key that unlocks the door of resentment and the handcuffs of hatred. It is a power that breaks the chains of bitterness and the shackles of selfishness. That's what forgiveness is. It unlocks those shackles. Here's an eighth and final point. You will be the primary beneficiary when you forgive another. It's interesting, when Lincoln was president, I read a book, Team of Enemies, I think it was called. And it talked about Lincoln and his team of leaders and how they were so competitive with each other and how he had a guy by the name of Stanton that just could not stand Lincoln and did everything he could to undermine him. But Lincoln kept him on because he said he is the most qualified for the position. That's statesmanship. And when Lincoln died, Stanton, having watched this man lead, was able to say, here lies the greatest man who has ever ruled. Here lies the greatest man that has ever ruled. Why? Because of how he could forgive people and still move forward. Back to Corrie Ten Boom. Her comment, forgiveness is unlocking the door to set someone free and realizing you are the prisoner. Isn't that a great statement? Forgiving that person, you think you're setting them free, and then you realize you were the prisoner. Another author said, forgiveness doesn't make the other person right, but it makes you free. That's our lesson on forgiveness today. Let me just give you a couple of verses and we'll wrap this up. The next two verses in the next chapter sort of follow this. I won't go into much detail, but let me show them to you. It says in verse 1 of Ephesians 5, follow God's example, therefore. In other words, that therefore says, based on all of this, follow God's example. Like dearly loved children. Now, children are interesting things. We are all children, and many of us have children. And we set examples for them And we try to set morally, being just and forgiving and merciful and truthful and honest and fair and loving. We are to imitate the moral example of God. Paul says, be conformed to his image. And he said, when you are, you will get the fullness of God. That's what he says, Ephesians 19. If we are conformed to his image, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. I want to be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. I want to remember I'm a dearly beloved child. I want to remember the Lord's prayer, forgive as Christ forgave me, when we are God's son. One more passage, verse 2, and we'll be done. And walk in the way of love, just as Jesus Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. When it talks about love, one of the best ways to measure your love and to see if you are growing in your spiritual walk is how forgiving you have become. And I know some people that never used to have a lick of forgiveness in them, it seemed like. But as I've gotten to see them grow older, I am just amazed at their ability now to not just forgive, but to forget the offenses and to move past that without bitterness. One final question.